Great. Good morning, William. And
good morning.
Good morning to everyone. Welcome to Module 7. As you can see on your screen, we'll be tackling taxation and financial reporting. William, we have about 180 participants online right now. I believe it's okay to start.
Thank you.
Great.
So thank you very much, Michelle. Good morning, everyone. And welcome to this webinar today on taxation and financial reporting. It's an important area that we will be looking at. It impacts on business people, large and small, and it can be an area that we ought to put some effort in managing the risks associated with taxation and financial reporting. I am William Kinai. Welcome to the presentation. So just allow me to proceed to the mission is to give you some understanding of the taxation laws that are relevant to businesses in Kenya and the specific financial reporting information that taxes are based on and that are useful for you as a business person, your investors and creditors, in order to make sound investment decisions. We will structure our presentation today as follows. We'll have a look at the taxes we have in Kenya, just a quick overview of the various taxes and the key provisions. Then we can talk about the tax planning. Then how can you manage disputes and resolve them? So allow me just to put off my video at this point in time for the sake of the bandwidth. At this point in time, so we can concentrate on our presentation. So our legislative framework in Kenya, we have the Constitution of 2020. Which provides certain provisions on how taxes should be levied and how taxes should be managed and how taxes should be collected. It provides the basis of taxation in Kenya. Then we have the statutory framework of taxation, which is based on five key pieces of legislation. We have the Tax Procedures Act 2015, which governs the taxation processes. We do have the Income Tax Act. We have the Value Added Tax and the Excise Duty Act. Then there is also the East African Community Customs Management Act of 2004 that seeks to harmonize custom taxes amongst the member countries of the East Africa Community. These are the principal laws that govern taxation in Kenya. Now, our taxes there, various taxes, they will, all firms undertaking business in Kenya. Regardless of the mode of registration, will be required to comply with the various taxes that may be levied. So of course, companies, limited liability companies, public limited companies that are resident are required to comply with taxes. Subsidiaries of companies, whether resident or non-resident, are required to comply with our tax laws, regardless of whether they are registered in Kenya or in foreign territory. Then branches of non-resident companies operating in Kenya. In the past, we have had organizations that have created marketing offices in Kenya. So the company is not registered as a company per se, but it does have an office in Kenya and that engages in trading and servicing its clientele. These branches, offices, are required to comply with our Kenyan tax code. Of course, partnerships and sole proprietorships are also required to comply. So the point is this, that any organization that is undertaking business activity are required to be in compliance with the tax laws in Kenya. So what I have projected here is a breakdown of the various taxes that we are to observe in Kenya. And these are basically classified under two categories. There are the direct taxes and the indirect taxes. You have under the direct taxes, this is where you have the turnover tax, and then you have the income tax. Income taxes are assessed on companies and on individual business people. Then there are also the withholding taxes on income tax, which are levied on incomes other than the business income earned by individuals. With regard to the indirect taxes, we have the value-added tax. There are agents who have been appointed as withholding VAT withholding tax agents. So there is the category of VAT withholding tax. And then there are the excise taxes that are levied on commodities that are traded in Kenya. So in a nutshell, we will classify our taxes under one of those two broad categories, the direct taxes and the indirect taxes. Then under that, depending on your organization, identify the taxes that you will be required to be in compliance with. So we'll have an overview of the various taxes. And our first tax is the turnover tax. This is a tax that you may consider to register for if you are, say, a small trader, you are operating as a sole proprietor, and you are receiving some amount of income. Allow me to mention that it gets to a point when you're doing business, you may have started as an informal business partner. It gets to a level where it is no longer possible to continue to operate informally. Turnover tax is applicable to those relatively small business person. Turnover tax is charged on your gross sales at 1% of your gross sales. It is a tax that is targeted at persons who are having turnover of between 1 million but less than 50 million. So anyone with a turnover in that region, you are eligible for registration for turnover tax. It is at 1% of gross sales. It is due on the 20th day of the following month. Today is the 19th. So people are filing for this by tomorrow midnight. So it's filed by midnight on the 20th. It is a final tax. You will not, the 1% is a final tax. You will not have deductions of expenses from it. It's taxed on your gross sales at 1%. It is a final tax. Are there exemptions? It is a tax that is eligible for incomes between 1 million and 50 million. It excludes employment income. It includes rental income. It includes management and professional incomes, which are subject to withholding tax, and any other income subject to a final withholding tax. Income subject to a final withholding tax will include the dividends and the interest incomes that you may receive. So turnover tax strictly applies on sales, your turnover at 1%. Is it mandatory? A taxpayer may opt out as business circumstances change. You may feel that you are more eligible to register for VAT and corporation tax. For whatever reason, a taxpayer may opt out of the turnover tax. The taxpayer must make a formal application to the Commissioner of Domestic Tax for the opting out, and it is subject to approval. It could take some duration of time, in which time before the approval is given, you are required to continue filing the returns until a final communication approval is made by the relevant representative of the tax authority. So the second tax we can talk about are the income tax, which are payable by both corporations, companies, as well as individual business people. Income tax is going to be charged on taxable income. The taxable income will be your net profit as per your audited accounts, which you are required to prepare annually, then depending on the size of your organization, if you have income tax, corporation tax, greater than 40,000 shillings, then your corporation tax is payable as an installment tax quarterly. So for the taxable income is considered to be your net profit as per your audited accounts, which you will prepare at the end of the financial year. And of course, any non-cash expenses, say for example, depreciation, will have to be added back in order to assess the taxable income. And I have mentioned that if the tax liability is greater than 40,000, then you will be required to pay it as an installment tax, which is payable quarterly. The rate of income tax for corporate residents is 30%. Corporate non-residents, these are branches of foreign companies operating in Kenya, say for example, conducting marketing activities in Kenya without being formally registered as a business entity, they are required to pay corporation tax at 37.5% of their net income, net profit. Then for partnerships, this will be at 30% of the share of the profit of the partner. And for the sole proprietor, it will be at your income tax liability as an individual, which is graduated at a scale that is current at the point in time the incomes were earned. When is it due? Corporation taxes, 25% is going to be paid by the 20th day of every fourth month. This is quarterly. And this applies to where the liability is greater than 40,000. There is the income tax, which is for individuals. This the income tax return is going to be filed on or before 6 months after the end of the accounting period. This is 30th June. And this applies for both companies as well as individuals. Is it mandatory? Income tax on profits from business activity may be opted out from. And once again, all is required is a written application to the Commissioner of Domestic Taxes, which is subject to approval. Remember, before the approval is released, you will be required to continue filing the returns for income tax until a point in time when the commissioner presents an approval that you have opted out. And that is another process altogether, because again, the commissioner will have to do their due diligence to confirm that the applicant is not in trading operations. So The returns must be filed by the 30th June of the year following the year when the profits, the net income was made. And if the liability is over 40,000, then you're required to pay it as an installment tax. There are the withholding taxes. Withholding taxes are taxes on incomes that are not necessarily profits and that are not payments to employees. Therefore, they are not subject to pay as you earn. So these are taxes that you will have to deduct from what you pay people who are not your employees, who have provided services to your organization. And the withholding tax will be on incomes, including, you know, the dividends, the interest income, royalties. What consultants earn is subject to withholding taxes. Pensions are also subject to withholding taxes. It is a tax that is going to be assessed by your organization on the incomes of people other than your employees. Then we have the value added tax, which is a mandatory tax for any organization that has a turnover of above 5 million shillings. The rates, there are the zero rated items, for example, anything you export or anything produced as at an export processing zone is charged at 0%. And also, the privileged persons, for example, the disabled persons also have the chargeable VAT at 0%. Petroleum products, look at your ETR return from the petrol station. VAT is at 8%. Then for general goods, the general rate for anything, more or less everything else you buy is going to be 16%. Then we also have exempted items. Exempted items are listed. It's a long list on the VAT Act. It's a long list. If you sell any of the exempted items, you are not required to register for VAT purposes. There is a list, the first schedule of the VAT Act presents a long list of items that are exempted from VAT. And this generally items that are exempted tend to be medical products, pharmaceutical products, medical products, food products, and then financial services generally. Although it's a long list of exceptions, exempted services, exempted goods. You can have a look at the VAT Act for the comprehensive list. These are just a few of items that I have just highlighted, just to emphasize that most of the products on the list tend to be of a pharmaceutical nature, financial services nature, and food nature. But it is a long list. Have a look at it in your own time. So there are the exempted goods, there's the 0%, then there are the 8% for fuel products and 16% for more or less every other consumer or industrial item product that is sold in Kenya. I can mention the withholding taxes. So this is where we are. Now, what are the obligations of a VAT taxpayer? Once you register as a VAT taxpayer on your iTax portal, you are required to notify them.
Sorry, William?
Yes?
If you could just go back a bit, I think we lost sound for a minute.
Okay.
Yeah, if you could go back to withholding tax.
Withholding tax?
That's where we last had you.
Okay, so that I was off air?
Yeah, you went, we couldn't hear for a minute there.
Sorry, okay, so now let me just go back to the slide on withholding taxes. Withholding taxes, you will be required to withhold taxes, to be a withholding tax collection agent where you pay people who are non-employees. These people you may be paying who are non-employees may include the consultants who work for your organization, for your company. You will withhold. The rates vary, consultants 10%, suppliers 2%, 6%, 10%. And this amount will be remitted by you, the collecting agent, to KRA. Then the taxpayer will receive a withholding tax certificate, which has to be declared when the taxpayer is filing their income tax returns for the financial period in question. So as your organization, your company, is a withholding tax collection agent where you make payments other than salaries and wages to your employees. So this applies when you make payments, for example, to suppliers. This applies when you make payments to consultants who give you professional services. This applies to commissions paid, especially by the insurance companies and to people marketing your products. This applies to on pensions paid by your organizations to retired staff. This applies to the interest you pay on your stocks, bonds, or whatever interest you pay on your bonds, and also the dividends that you pay as an organization to your shareholders. So any other payment other than salaries and wages to employees will be eligible for payments of withholding tax. Your organization becomes a withholding tax collection agent, and you are required to submit the relevant rate for that particular item to KRA. Then the individual taxpayer, this is your supplier or your consultant, will have to declare the withholding tax certificates they will have received following your payment of the withholding tax. Really, this is a tax that ensures that you remit part of the tax liability and the individual is going to declare that income. And after that income is declared, at the point in time when the individual files their tax returns, any extra amount of money payable on that tax will have to be paid by the individual taxpayer. So withholding tax, you collect it, you remit it to KRA, it depends on the percentage, 2%, 6%, 10%, depending on the item, and you will remit this as a withholding tax collection agent. So if you're, when it gets to the point of dividends, when it gets to the point of interest, when it comes to working with consultants, you become a withholding tax collection agent. You're required to comply with the withholding tax regulations. Am I clear? Michelle? Am I audible?
Yes, yes, you are.
Okay, so thank you. So we can now proceed to the value added tax. You have to register for withholding tax if you have sales of more than 5 million shillings. Some mandatory registration is required. The rates that you VAT is chargeable, of course, there are zero rated items. Zero rated items include anything you export. Your VAT tax rate, 0%. You produce whatever you produce in Kenya, you export the item, it's at a 0% VAT. Items that are produced at the export processing zone are zero rated for VAT purposes. Then of course there are privileged persons and public bodies that are also exempted from VAT taxes. Petroleum products, look at the ETR receipt you get when you buy petrol at your petrol station. This is at 8%. For petroleum products, rate is 8%. Then for the general rate for more or less all other consumer items and industrial goods, the rate is 16%. We do have exempted items. These are exempted items are listed on the first schedule of the VAT Act. Majority of exempted item I have mentioned are items that are either of a pharmaceutical nature, items used in healthcare, to food items, agricultural products, and financial services. This includes, you know, our accounts, you know, bank accounts are not charged VAT, insurance services are not charged VAT. So generally food items, healthcare items, and financial services are exempted. No, even on interest, when you take a loan, the interest is not charged value-added tax. So my emphasis is in there, those items that are exempted, these items are generally pharmaceutical items, food items, and financial services listed on the VAT Act first schedule. It's a long list. You can have a look at it in your own time. If you are dealing in an exempt item, you do not need to register for value added tax. And that is why you find, like, say, for example, many of our people who deal with food items are not registered. No, generally, the informal sector in the market where we buy food, they operate in this sector. They are not, they tend not to be registered for VAT items. Then obligations. What are you required to? In the event that you change your name, your business name, your address, your place of business, your nature of business, you introduce a new line of item that you're dealing in, you are required to notify the commissioner of VAT of the change in your business. This change is to be made within 21 days of the change. Any changes, business address, new line of business, any change in your business, notify to the commissioner. The return generally filed by midnight of the 20th day of the month following the month which the VAT relates to. So, and then of course, the tax authority expects that as you file the return, you will make payment. So this is assuming you're filing the return on the 20th, the tax authority expects you to pay for the tax liability, VAT tax liability by the 20th. And this is a tax that attracts penalties. If you forget to file it and you file it, you delay in filing and you file after, you know, midnight of the 20th, by morning you will have a penalty in your inbox. So this is a tax that attracts penalties for not filing, and there is also interest that accrues on any amount that is not paid over time. It's and because it is a return that is made monthly, the exposure for this could be relatively high if you have non-compliance. So it just makes lots of sense. Just file it way before the 20th. Don't wait for the last minute. You may have a breakdown that you cannot salvage. So allow me to just recap on the taxes that we have talked about. We have talked about those taxes. They are the turnover taxes, 1% of sales. There are the income taxes. For residents, we pay them at 30% with regard to companies. For individuals, this will be graduated at the scale. Personal income taxes are paid to at the current point in time. We have mentioned there's the value added tax for anyone doing business over 50 million, over 5 million shillings. A mandatory registration is required. And then, of course, there are the excise taxes, which are on certain other commodities, cigarettes, alcohol, airtime, water, so on and so forth. And then there are the withholding taxes that you will be required to collect on behalf of the tax collection agency and remit. This is with regard to any payments you make to persons other than your employees. So now I'd like us to mention something about tax planning. So why are we interested in tax planning? Why we can engage, and probably two ideas we can share about which are legally allowed here. It is possible to reduce your tax liability. It is possible to reduce your tax liability using instruments that are allowed, particularly in the Income Tax Act. So you can reduce your tax liability. At least two areas that we can mention specifically that you could use to reduce your tax liability. Why? Now, with tax planning, what do you want? As a business person, my intention is to reduce the amount I pay in taxes. For small business people, but cash is a rare commodity. It's rare, really, really, really rare. Small business people generally tend to be under cash flow issues most of the time. So as far as possible, you may want to reduce your tax liability as an individual business person. On the other hand, Kenya Revenue Authority has to collect taxes and has to collect the maximum taxes possible. So the question is, what are the opportunities you have to legally reduce your tax liability? There are devices that are available to individuals as well as business to be able to reduce their tax liability. The income tax does allow individual taxpayers to reduce their tax liability legally. And we will be explaining at least two of these opportunities that are available within the Income Tax Act. The first one is this. We do have a mortgage interest deduction for mortgage interest you pay, provided that this mortgage interest was paid for an occupied residential property. And this is the deduction will be up to 300,000 shillings per annum. So from your income tax liability, you get a 300,000 mortgage interest relief by occupying a house, being bought on mortgage, provided the lender issues you with a mortgage interest certificate. So it is a way that as a business person, you can be able to reduce your tax liability legally by claiming the mortgage interest relief up to 300,000 shillings per annum. It is a significant amount. Then the second one is this. You can claim in your income tax return, you can claim an insurance relief. And this is going to be granted to somebody who paid some insurance premiums, either for life, medical, or education policies for you and your family. And from the 1st of January 2022, any payment you make to the National Housing Insurance Fund, NHIF, is still eligible to the insurance relief. A lot of small business people are covered by NHIF. So from this year onwards, you will be able to get a relief of 15% of the premiums paid up to a maximum of 60,000 shillings per annum. So these are provisions that are available. You can legally reduce your tax liability as an individual by claiming an insurance relief on your life insurance policy, medical policy, or education policy that you are paying to cover your family or your contributions to the NHIF up to a maximum of 60,000 shillings. Then also you have a mortgage interest relief. It does make sense to own a house through mortgage, and you can claim a mortgage interest relief of up to 300,000 shillings per annum. So point is this, the Income Tax Act does allow you to reduce your tax liability legally. So the point is, can you identify what opportunities are at your disposal that you can utilize and which are legal, they are above board, and which you can utilize in the interest of furthering your business objectives. So these are things you can identify with some professional help. So as you plan for your taxes, number one, always compliance is the best policy. Don't wait to be found out. Incorporate compliance into your strategy. Have an intention to comply. It will save you headache later on. So seek the relevant advice from the very beginning. I will mention at this point in time, you can talk to your auditor, whoever audits your accounts, whoever prepares your audited accounts, talk to them, let them advise you on your tax. Talk to your tax consultants, talk to your auditor. Also, once you register for a PIN, personal identification number with the Kenya Revenue Authority, your PIN has an account manager at the Kenya Revenue Authority. That person will also, your account manager will also guide you. Call them, let them explain your position, explain where you are at, let them explain you on what is required. They give you good advice of what you should comply. So the emphasis here is in that as far as possible, at the onset of your business activity, have an intention to comply. Let it be your strategy to comply. It is more efficient to comply than to try and remedy the penalties and the interest later on. They can take you out of business. So avoid penalties, avoid interest accruing on amounts not paid. Talk to tax consultants, talk to your auditor, talk to your KRA account manager. Let them explain you what is required, how it is required, how they can help. They are helpful people working for the agent. Yeah, I mean, they will give you the advice of what to do by when. Then also pay the correct rate for the category of tax you are paying. It always makes sense to use the correct rate. Talk to your auditor, talk to your tax consultant, talk to your KRA account manager. Let them confirm the correct rates. For larger businesses, it makes lots of sense to have your own tax team in your finance department, people who ensure compliance on tax matters. For very many businesses, you know, you are forced to hire a team of tax people, probably, especially if you have many transactions, to do your VAT returns, you know, something that is ongoing daily in the tax team, within the tax team, to ensure that the deadlines are met. So for a larger business organization, have a tax team, have a compliance team that ensures that you are in compliance with your tax requirements. You attain the due dates for filing the returns and making payments to the relevant tax authority. Then there are also private rulings. Where you want a tax law to be interpreted, you can make an application to the commissioner, the relevant commissioner at KRA, and request an explanation, a private ruling of the treatment of a particular item you need to be confirmed. So if there's something that is not certain, you cannot get a good explanation from your tax consultant, it makes sense to get an interpretation of that matter, of that tax law, from the commissioner of KRA for the particular tax you require clarification about. So as far as possible, you know, target 100% compliance to all tax regulations. I think I've gone back. Yes, this is where I'm supposed to be. In tax planning, you have to consider tax gross ups. These are amounts that can offset, reduce your taxes. For example, there are the amounts you make as an employer, as contributions for NSSF and NHIF of your employees. The items that you can treat as, which will reduce your income tax liability. then consider what expenses do you have, what taxes do you have to register for? Of course, there's the income tax, there is the VAT or turnover tax. As a business at your stage, identify what taxes you are eligible to. Talk to your tax consultant, let them advise you on what would make sense to register. Will you register for turnover tax? Will you register for VAT? What tax should you, depending on your business circumstances? Then also you need to take note of the non-deductible expenses. And there are quite a number of non-deductible expenses. This includes things like depreciation and depletion. The way we treat them in financial accounting and also goodwill and startup expenses for that matter, the way we treat them in financial accounting, they may be considered to be non-deductible expenses. Then there are also qualifications as to what interest expenses can be deducted as expenses, same thing as bad debts, same thing as charitable contributions, absolutely any fines and penalties and taxes you pay. There are limitations as to whether you can treat them as expenses. Your net trading losses will not necessarily be treated as expenses. And then any payments you make to foreign affiliates, for example, your company pays a management fee to one of your companies registered elsewhere, not in Kenya. There are limitations to these non-deductible expenses in accordance to our Kenyan law. So again, the best advice here would be, as you consider your expenses, get good tax advice from your tax consultant, your auditor, on the treatment of these expenses. There are provisions of the tax laws in Kenya that limit what you can treat as a deductible expense. Then still on taxes, a requirement of the Income Tax Act that any benefit you give to an employee that is over 3,000 shillings per month will be taxable. So it's something that you have to take into consideration. All the benefits, all the payrolls, anything that is over 3,000 a month will not be treated as a business, will be taxable on the employee who has received that pay. And that applies for housing, for transport allowances we get as employees. That applies for basically the only benefit that is not taxable on the employee is the medical cover benefit. But more or less any other benefit you give to your employees over 3,000 shillings is taxable on your employees. Then there are the import costs, damages, storage costs. When you do not clear your stuff promptly on arrival, it may result in an accumulation of penalties and accumulation of interest to the extent that you may be unable to clear, or it does not make economic sense to continue with that transaction, you end up abandoning the imported goods. So just take note of all the documentation that is required with regard to imported items. Have it well in advance that you're not looking for it when those items finally arrive, just to reduce damage costs. Then you have the incomes and incentives you have to consider when you're planning for your taxes. You can take advantage of the allowable deductions. For example, the capital allowances. We call them wear and tear allowances. These are the allowances that are allowable for on your property, plant, and equipment investment for the long-lived assets. So these will be subject to an wear and tear allowance that allows the cost of those assets to be spread for a number of years. You can take these into consideration. If you declare that you have property, plant, and equipment in your audited accounts, then those declared property, plant, and equipment will be eligible for wear and tear allowances. To a certain extent, there are non-cash benefits that can be given to employees. And mainly here, I have mentioned that medical cover benefit is a benefit you can give to your employees that is not taxable on the employee's income. Then there are the insurance premiums. There are limits according to the schedule provided in the Income Tax Act that is currently in use. And then again, you can manage your tax overpayments. KRA allows you to pay an advance tax. So if you are expecting that you will be having a large transaction in a particular month, KRA allows you to make an advance tax. That is okay. There's no question. I mean, it's allowed. You can register the advance tax and pay the advance tax. Where you find that you have made excess payment after you file your return and you find that you had made an excess payment, it is possible to apply for a refund of the excess payments that you have made. So you can manage your tax overpayments and through the application of the refunds. So take into consideration how you can use wear and tear allowances to reduce your tax liabilities. Non-cash benefits, say for example, medical cover benefits, is a benefit that is not taxable on the employee's income. Insurance contributions up to a certain point will also not attract additional tax liability on the part of employees. You can also request the payment of overpayment of taxes. Other considerations, it is always prudent to have an external person review your tax compliance. It makes sense over time to get a tax consultant to review your tax compliance at least annually. It's prudent, especially after the passing of the new finance bill. It is always necessary to engage a tax consultant and get advice on compliance issues to ensure that your compliance will not result in penalties later on. Also, consider including in your budget an amount for your tax consultants. If it is your auditor, what they will be charging you for purposes of a tax consultancy. Include it in your budget. Review, have a review of the contract. What will they be required to do for your organization? So include clauses in the contract that specify your expectations of the tax consultant. Make necessary tax provisions, make necessary write-offs, especially of assets that are condemned and that have no value. Where you have an exemption from one of the taxes, it is in order to have a validation of those exemption certificates. You know, even those withholding tax certificates, it is necessary that you validate those withholding tax certificates. Validate those exemptions that are presented to you, tax certificates that are presented to you. Then note that there may be reviews of the tax codes by domestic tax commissioner and the customs commissioner. These rates are reviewed. Recently, we saw a review of the excise tax, which went upwards, pegged on the rate of inflation. So just keep note, as you plan, these taxes may not be constant. There may be reviews by the Commissioner of Domestic Taxes and also for the custom taxes. Taxes may be reviewed, be able to plan for those reviews. Now, question arises, what do you do if you have a dispute with the tax collection agent? What should you do? There are processes that are provided by law in Kenya for the resolution of tax disputes. First and foremost, our Constitution of 2010 does provide that no tax or license can be imposed or waived unless it is provided for by legislation. So all taxes are based on some law. Any waiver on those taxes is based on a law. Any change on those taxes is based on a law. That is why it is essential to consult your tax consultant after every finance bill is passed, just to be up to date with the new provisions that have been proposed in the finance bill of every year. So we have a Tax Procedures Act, which intends to harmonize and consolidate the procedural rules of administration of taxes in Kenya. And it specifically mentions that unless a tax law specifies a procedure that is unique to the administration of that tax, the procedure applied under the Tax Procedure Act shall apply. So again, our laws in Kenya are based on legislation that has been passed and that has the power of law. And that's their, how they will be changed. That is how taxes can be waived or changed. Now, where do the disputes arise from? Disputes will arise from any one of the acts and any subsidiary legislation that may be based on one of the acts on which those laws are based on. So there will be disputes that will emanate from each and every Act of Parliament and the interpretation that you may make or your agents may make on the basis of the various laws, Income Tax Act, Value Added Tax, the Excise Duty Act, Miscellaneous Fees and Levies Act, or the other subsidiary legislations and regulations that may be passed from a ministerial level. We have the East Africa Community Customs Act, which aims at harmonizing the administration of customs amongst the East Africa Community member countries. The treatments each country makes of the various procedures may be another source of disputes. Then we have the KRA post-clearance audits. This impacts on mainly the importers and exporters. Tax Procedures Act requires that you retain your documentary evidence of transactions for 5 years. And a post-clearance audit can be conducted on the basis of the documentary evidence held, which must go 5 years into the past. And these are, so all those transactions that relate to imports and exports, a post-clearance audit can be required and are being required, and business people who are in the import and export field are being impacted on by the post-clearance audits. So the key point here is that to avoid any disputes that could arise, documentation, evidence of transactions ought to be retained for a period of 5 years. What happens when Kenya Revenue Authority wants to audit you? The first thing that will happen is that you get a notification that there is an intention to have you audited. So there will be an intention of an audit. There will be a request for information. Then an audit will be undertaken where the agents of the tax authority will review your documentary evidence of transactions. So they will undertake a review of your documentation. They will try and have a picture of what you do, how you keep your records, and they will undertake a review. They will seek clarifications. Then there is a post-audit phase whereby findings will be presented, clarifications may be sought, and additional tax assessment may be made on the basis of the findings of that tax audit. But the key point here is this, that a notification will be given, a request for information will be provided, then the audit will take place. So the key thing is, do you have your documentation? Do you have your transactions archived in hard copy and in soft copy? So it makes lots of sense to scan all your documentary evidences and store them scanned, as well as have an archive for the physical documents themselves. And according to Tax Procedures Act, you're required to hold this evidence of transactions for a period of 5 years. The types of revenue audits conducted, you could have a desktop audit where the tax staff from KRA will request some clarification or amendment, either by phone or on email. Mostly we receive the emails, or a review of the taxes that you have paid. You can have a desktop audit. You can have a field audit where they will physically come and inspect your records, inspect your archived documents, look at what you have backed up on your backup services, on the cloud, wherever you back up. That information may also be accessed. Then also, there is the mixed audit, which will look at all electronic, all correspondence, all returns, all interactions you have ever engaged with your iTax system, plus a review of your physical documentation. It's a more in-depth audit that you will get to uncover whether the taxes you paid for were what you should have paid for. So looking at it from the perspective of the depth of the audit, we classify audits from the point of view of the depths of the audits from four perspectives. You have a compliance audit. Did you file your returns? Did you file your income tax return? Did you file your VAT returns? Were you in compliance? Were there penalties? What amounts did you pay? There is a compliance audit. When this is complied with, this is the basis on which we get our tax compliance certificate. At least the bare minimum has been met. You have your tax compliance certificate. You file your returns, and the amounts that were to be paid based on your returns have been made. It's a compliance audit. You can have a normal audit, which will have a look at longer periods of time, a number of years. You can have an in-depth audit, which will look at a mix of documentation. It will look at your documentary evidence, your archived documents, as well as the electronic documents. Then you can have a formal investigation when you are suspected, where your company is suspected of tax evasion or aggressive tax avoidance. not playing by the rules of tax law. These do happen. You have seen of companies that have been shut down in the last 2 years because of precisely suspected tax evasion. It can take you out of business. So what do you do? Seek professional advice. Engage. Usually for smaller companies, the first person you can talk to on compliance matters is your auditor. For a larger company, you can engage a tax consultant. Engage the tax consultant. Agree on what are the terms, what is the scope of the advice that will be provided. Assuming that you have already received a notice of an audit from KRA, you have to set a time frame with your tax consultant to be able to meet the timeline you have also been provided by KRA. So as you seek professional assistance, let the timelines be harmonized with the timelines that you have been given by KRA. Then you can now begin the review of your documentation, financial, electronic, archived documents of your financial transactions. Then at the end of the engagement with your tax consultant, you will get a report which will identify the risks that ought to be addressed. What are the risks? What are the remedies? What you can do? So at the end of it, there will be an assessment of risk, action points that you can take to mitigate those compliance risks that your business is exposed to. It makes sense to get professional assistance, especially for the smaller businesses. A good starting point would be talk to your auditor. If you're larger, talk to a tax consultant. Let them do a tax review for your business. Let them identify the compliance risks you're exposed to. Seek professional assistance. Where are you exposed? The first area you are exposed is pay as you earn. What you deduct on the salaries of your employees. It's your first exposure. Second exposure are the statutory deductions. Number one, NSSF, are you compliant? Number two, NHIF, are you compliant? Number three, there is NITA, the National Industrial Training Authority. Are you in compliance with those deductions? Then there are the corporation tax compliance and withholding tax compliances. Here, when you declared a profit, did you remit the corporation tax? Did you use the correct rate? Dividends that were paid to your shareholders, did you withhold the withholding tax attributed to the dividends you paid? Was it remitted? There are the indirect taxes. And this is where the value-added tax and this value-added tax and turnover tax fall under. You have the transfer pricing, where you have a company that is affiliated to your company that operates offshore at another location, and you bill management services, for example, it's considered to be transfer pricing. It's an area of exposure. You have the customs duty and levies that are payable on import and export items. And then, of course, there are the regulatory compliances. Regulatory compliances, this is where I will put in taxes such as the standardization levy, which again is collected by KRA on behalf of the Kenya Bureau of Standards. There is the catering levy trustees that is collected by restaurants for the purposes of financing the activities in the tourism, training activities in the tourism sector. So you have these six areas which you are exposed to. Where are you most vulnerable? Develop a matrix. Identify what are the risks. There are those low risk items, which are things you need to note, dates you need to note, dates you need to comply with. It's a relatively low risk. You have the medium risk items. These are items that could potentially result in an exposure. By exposure, we mean a penalty or interest. Then there are those items that are high risk, which have already crystallized as exposures, where you already have a penalty, where you already have interest to pay. So categorize all the items presented above in this risk matrix. Identify in each of these areas where your company is at. Do compliance in those areas expose you at a low risk, medium risk, or high risk? Then, once the audit is complete, once the audit is complete, you will have to clear the outstanding matters. Any information that is requested will have to be provided. Any clarification requested will have to be provided. So provide any figures, queries that may have been made will be made in writing by the tax agent, tax authority representatives. It will be in writing, address those matters, to provide the relevant evidence that has been requested in writing. Then any assessment that is made on you, again, it must have a legal basis, that there must be a justifiable reason for any additional assessment. At the end of this tax audit, there will be an audit findings that will be presented. The audit findings will indicate any requests for more information, any clarifications that will be sought. There will be a list of issues that have emerged during the audit. and or observations that have been made by the KRA representatives, agents during the audit. They will list what these items are, and there will be the closure. You are either compliant, you're clean. Alternatively, you may be subjected to an additional tax assessment for taxes that you did not comply with, which have to be paid or get into a plan. If you object to the additional tax assessment, you can dispute, you can give a notice of the intention to. So how the process works, first there will be the issue of an intention to audit, which you will receive in writing, in email, from the tax agency representative. Then the audit is going to be done based on the objective set in the notice. A tax demand, if there is a non-compliance, will be made. Then, according to the Tax Procedures Act, Section 51, Subsection 2, you can object, you are allowed to object to the tax demand made on the basis of the non-compliance. And that now brings you to how you resolve the dispute. The taxpayer objects the demand. An independent review of that objections will be sought. Then the KRA representatives will accept, amend, or reject that objection. If it is accepted, it can go to the next step where there will be an issue of an appeal to the Tax Appeal Tribunal. Relevant documentation will be provided to the Tax Appeal Tribunal. If the ruling by the Tax Tribunal is not acceptable, the taxpayer can still escalate the matter to the High Court, and the matter can still be escalated further to the Court of Appeal. So it would mean that as a taxpayer, you would have to make the decision, are you willing to escalate the matter? What will it cost you? What will be the legal costs? What will be the risks that, what are the risks? What is the chances that the additional assessment will be objected later on? So you will have to make a decision, consider the costs and benefits of escalating the matter further on, depending on your financial resources. Yes, so I think that's all we could have talked about. We have talked about the various taxes that you are subject to. We have talked about tax planning, using opportunities such as, say, for example, interest insurance relief, mortgage interest relief, using wear and tear allowances on your property, plant, and equipment assets to reduce your tax liability. These are things that are legal and are allowed by tax laws. So there are those opportunities. We have looked at how you can go about to resolve a dispute with the tax authority. It will depend on the nature. You will get a notice you will get a request for information, an audit will be conducted, and the matter will be brought to a conclusion, either by being given a clean bill of health, you're compliant, or alternatively, you will have an additional assessment, which you have the right to appeal all the way to the Court of Appeal. And just as emphasis as we conclude, it makes sense to talk to gurus, you know, the tax consultants who will give you advice. Makes sense, talk to them. It's better you plan to comply from the very beginning. Engage your auditor, engage your tax consultant. Get the advice earlier on rather than later on. Then number two, tax evasion can be very expensive. Again, emphasis is on compliance. Evasion can be expensive because you will have to invest in litigation. Again, very expensive. Then lastly, emphasis again, compliance is low cost, efficient, and effective. You're better off talking to your auditor on tax issues, you're better off talking to your tax consultant, you're better talking to your KRA account manager for advice on how to pay and how to comply. It's easier. Fact is, we cannot avoid paying taxes. It's more efficient to comply. So thank you very much. So I think we can open to questions at this point and comments.
Thank you very much, William.
Thank you.
We have a lot of questions waiting for you. This session was quite interesting for the participants.
Mm-hmm.
They loved engaging in it.
Okay, so yes.
Yeah. So we can move over to the Q&A section.
Q&A, this turnover tax is charged monthly. It's charged absolutely every month. Turnover tax, it's for businesses that have turnover between 1 million and 50 million shillings. VAT is for, ideally VAT is for businesses with turnover over 5 million shillings, although you can still register if you have turnover of less than 5 million shillings. You can still register for VAT. What is the meaning of a final withholding tax? For example, the taxes on dividends and the taxes on interest income, there will be no additional requirement to pay anything after it has been deducted. However, what you earn as a consultant, the company paying you will retain a portion. The other portion you will be required to pay when you file your tax return for that year later on. So on dividends interest, you have a final withholding tax. For earnings of, say, for example, consultants, there may be the requirement to pay something additional when you file your tax returns. What steps can we take to opt out of tax once we dissolve the business we are paying taxes for? Now, here you have to be very careful. Once you opt out, you receive a notification, system generated, that your application has been received. No, it's system generated, comes to your email almost immediately after you have made the application to opt out. However, you ought to continue filing the tax returns until the time KRA issues you with formal notification that a particular tax has been, you're no longer eligible for that tax or that PIN has been withdrawn. So just getting a notification that your application has been received does not mean you stop filing the returns. You continue filing the nil return until you get the formal communication that that PIN has been shut down or that tax liability has been withdrawn from KRA. Otherwise, you will get the penalty for not filing the return. And usually that will not be waived. On what, on withholding tax, what does it mean as a recipient and what are the implications of it? Especially, say for example, people who supply government institutions. The government institution will retain the withholding tax. Then when you file for, this is on the VAT for example. So you have supplied a public institution. The public institution pays you less withholding tax, which that organization remits to KRA. So if they retain 2% or 6%, the remaining amount you will have to pay when you declare your VAT for that particular month. So having a withholding tax, for example, as a supplier, it has an implication that you have to file your VAT return and you have to either pay the other amount or charge it against your input taxes that are relevant for that period in question. Hello, for VAT, if you have turnover of 5 million, is it a must to register? But should I also register if I am buying products with VAT and charging VAT to clients that need ETR? I have mentioned that you can register for VAT even if your turnover is not 5 million. The reality of business is that most of the people you deal with business want you to give them an ETR. So you will have to register for VAT even before you hit 5 million. And that's why I talked about getting advice. What do you want? What, get advice from your auditor or your tax consultant. Will you go the turnover tax way or will you go the VAT way? A lot of business people prefer to register for VAT at the beginning of the business, even before they begin making a sale. So you can register for VAT even before you reach a turnover of 5 million. Register for it. Most business people prefer to pay for VAT than to pay for turnover tax. This is a reality. And it is because most of your customers will ask for an ETR whenever you transact. So you can register for VAT before you hit 5 million turnover. If you are not registered for VAT and your suppliers charge you VAT on goods, for example, construction, can you withhold VAT and pay KRA? I don't think it's because you're not registered for VAT. So you're not registered for VAT. So if you're not registered for VAT, then you will just have to bear the VAT that is charged by your suppliers on you. You cannot treat it as an input tax. So whatever purchases we make, the VAT on those purchases we treat it as an input tax, which reduces the VAT liability output tax. So we pay the net VAT when we file our returns on the 20th. So you have to be registered for VAT in order to charge VAT input tax on the VAT output tax you charge your customers when you sell them. VAT registration is absolutely necessary. Then we have a question. Being a student, I didn't manage to file my returns. Can charges be waived? The amount penalized is too high for a student who is a dependent. Thank you. So what you can do, there is a department 14th floor at Times Tower that deals with the waivers. Go and argue your case, give a reason why, they will give you a hearing. You can explain you are not in employment, and you can give the reasons, like reasons of sickness. If you are sick during that time, you failed to file your return, they will waive the return. Even for other cases where you have a retired person, they will give you a fair hearing. So 14th floor, Times Tower, consult with them. Let them, they will give you a hearing. They can waive the penalties and interest. How do you treat Christmas vouchers given to staff? That's a good one. How do you treat Christmas vouchers given to staff? Remember that any benefit given to employees over 3,000 shillings is taxable. So how much are you giving as a Christmas voucher? Remember the 3,000. Any benefit to your employees over 3,000 shillings will be treated as an employment income, as a benefit from employment. That's the correct term, as a benefit from employment. So if you can keep it under the 3,000, that will be safe. It will not attract additional taxes. Then, good morning. What taxes are to be paid when renting a property as core business? What taxes are to be paid when renting a property as a core business? So I presume here you are a landlord and your core business is renting out property. So it depends. The rules we have on rented property, if the property is rented out to residential customers, so you have tenants who live in the house, the rate is 10% of the rental income as a final tax. You cannot charge your expenses. So it's 10% on residential property, final tax. If it is a commercial property, you will be required to charge VAT on the rent. And your tenants can also treat the VAT they pay on the rent as an input tax, VAT input tax. So it depends. Is the property residential? Is the property for commercial purposes? Residential, 10% final tax. For commercial property, VAT is chargeable and payable on commercial properties. Your tenants can claim it, the VAT, as an input tax. For small businesses with very little profits, what's the best tax option? Also, if they have registered their business but are not making enough profits, what is the way forward? Now, small businesses, we have a challenge because we're making, we don't have money, cash flows are small, rather small, number one. Number two, then when you want to comply, there is a compliance cost. So what I can advise for small businesses that are making little profits, it makes lots of sense to have a PIN for the business, register the business. I'm assuming it's a company, a small company. You've registered the company. You have taken a PIN for the company, and you just begin charging. You can begin charging for the various taxes. You can charge for VAT, file your VAT return. At the end of the year, file for the income tax. Now, if you are not making profits, what you will be doing is that you will be having VAT credits. You will be having corporation tax credits. So where you're not making profits, where you're making losses, you will have credits for VAT as well as corporation tax. So the point is, it doesn't make much sense to hide yourself just because your sales are small. Begin compliance at the very beginning. We have another question. What are some of the legal ways of minimizing my SME business consulting tax liability? So how are you doing business? It will make sense to, number one, register for your taxes, avoid penalties that can come later on. You will be getting paid. You will be getting paid by your clients. They pay you. They are having withholding certificates. The name, your name or the name of your business and the PIN of your business and your own PIN is appearing on that withholding tax certificate. It does not make sense to hide. For your small business, just register for your relevant tax liabilities, whether it is VAT, whether it's corporation tax, then prepare your income statement, your accounts at the end of the year. You may have to engage an accountant for that. It will cost you. There is a compliance cost there. It will make sense just to comply. If you're making a loss, you have a tax credit. If you make a profit, you can find money and pay KRA. So it makes sense just to be compliant in your situation, whether you're a small business or a large business. So again, how do you treat tax? How do you treat Christmas vouchers given to your staff? I think this is the second time this is coming. Is it taxable or tax exempt? I have said that any benefit to your employees more than 3,000 shillings is taxable on the employees. That's in the Income Tax Act. Then again, if there is an issue with those Christmas vouchers that you're giving or any other vouchers you're giving, get the advice of your account, KRA account manager. Let them explain to you how they would want you to treat those Christmas vouchers. If they want you to tax them, even if they are less than 3,000, treat them as advised by your KRA account manager. So how do you tax gratuity paid? This gratuity would be eligible to be taxed as a pension, which is subject to withholding tax. So it will be treated as it will be taxed at the relevant withholding tax rate for pensions. What is the minimum rent received for me to qualify to the 10% rental income per month? There is no minimum rent. Even if you're getting a rent of 2,000 shillings, 10% of that is payable as tax on residential property rented out. So even if it is 2,000, you are required to pay 10%. So really there is no minimum. It is on any income received on residential property. And here it is also necessary to note that especially in the urban areas like Nairobi, this applies. If you have a residential property, KRA has mapped them out. They know where the property is. They know the LR number. They have done an audit of how many units. So especially in the urban spaces, it's hard to avoid this. Most of the urban spaces and the rental properties in the urban spaces have been mapped out. So it makes sense to comply. So what does the law allow claim of up to 150% on capital expenditure used to develop a business facility before starting the business? If yes, how long? If no, why? For you to claim the extra 150, you will need to get an investment certificate with this organization is called what? The one that gives a certificate. They operate from railways. This is Investment Proportion Center. The ones that give at railway, you have to have this certificate as the basis of claiming the 150% capital expenditure for developing business. So the key thing here would be, have you received that capital investment certificate from the Investment Promotion Center? And once you have that investment certificate, you can now look at what are the requirements, but you must have the investment certificate issued before you can claim the wear and tear allowances, the income, the capital expenditure allowance, 150%. For SMEs that can't afford a financial advisor, are there institutions that you know that can help? For SMEs, honestly, I do not think you can do without an auditor. Because even as a business person, as a sole proprietor, how will you comply with VAT or turnover tax? Number one. Number two, how will you, now that you are operating in a place, you have a business license, for example, which you can't avoid, that data also reads at KRA. So once you get out of, into formal business, you are at a, let me call it a main street location, it is harder to avoid. You have a business license. The data is with KRA. It's much harder to avoid paying taxes. So you will need a financial advisor. So what I can suggest is this. to file your income, and to file your turnover tax, and to file your VAT return on a monthly basis. You can do it yourself. You can learn how to do it. You can get someone to teach you how to file the turnover tax return and how to file the VAT return. Then when it comes to the end of the year, when you're filing your income tax return, even as a sole proprietor, you will need an auditor who is going to prepare your financial statements. And remember, these financial statements are the basis of your income tax. As a business person, you need the audited financial statements. That is what KRA wants, audited financial statements. You cannot avoid having an auditor who is going to be your financial advisor. How do we identify our tax managers at KRA? Easy. From your PIN certificate, you have a station. So Western Station, Upper Hill Station, Starehe, if you're in Nairobi, you are at a particular station. Call that station. Give them your PIN number. Find out who is your KRA tax manager. They give good advice, especially if you're a small business and you cannot afford the services of an auditor or a tax advisor. You are starting out. It is always good to talk to your KRA account manager, especially when you're starting. Let them give you the advice, what you should do, by when. It's always safe. Just look at your PIN certificate, where the particular office they sit in. You will get it from your PIN, then make a follow-up call, get an explanation of what you should do. Revenue audit by KRA. How long is the pre-audit, post-audit? Can it go beyond 4 years? Now, with regard to how long this can take, how long it can take, usually you will get a notice that from KRA that we intend to audit you. So they will give you the documentations you will be required to present. Then here is where I again say the Tax Procedures Act specifically requires that you retain evidence of all your transactions for 5 years. So any evidence of transaction, 5 years, you will still have to retain the document. A notice will be given, 21 days, so you will have time to put your house in order, get all the relevant documentation that you need, anything archived, locate it in the archive, anything backed up electronically, locate it from your backups. So a notice will be given. Then the rest, just leave it to KRA. It should be, the matter should be concluded promptly. It can not go for 4 years. 4 years, it's rather too long into the future. It ends. It cannot continue for 4 years, really. So, but a notice will be given for the audit. Then an audit will be done, and then you will get an audit closing meeting, and that is where you'll be presented with a report. Either you are compliant or you are billed for additional taxes. But it cannot continue 4 years. To clarify, did you say that once you have an individual PIN, there's a tax manager at KRA allocated to your PIN. Yes, every PIN has a relevant KRA account manager. There's someone who supervises your PIN at KRA. If you're in business, that's the first person you should get advice from. Yes, every PIN has an account manager. Then if you register an individual PIN and it had a payee obligation registered erroneously by a cyber cafe and you did not notice it for a long time, can it be removed? Yes, it can be removed. You would just have to apply for the removal of that tax obligation. And usually when you make an application, you may even be called for an interview to explain the circumstances. Yes, it can, but you will have to make an application for the obligation to be removed. How do you do ANITA as statutory deductions? If you are in an organization that could benefit from industrial training, you will be required to register with NITA. NITA provides industrial training. So once your organization is registered for NITA, the NITA payments are going to be remitted on a monthly basis to NITA. So question is your organization registered for NITA? If you've been registered for NITA, you will be required to pay for these statutory deductions that relate to NITA. Then when I propose to offer consultancy services, how do I include the withholding tax in the financial proposal? Should it be 5% or 30% of the total fee? Your consultancy fees, once you bill them, which you may or may not charge VAT, depending on whether you are registered for VAT or not, the payment that is payable to you. You know, what you should be working on is you should be working on billing the 16% VAT on the value of the consultancy services provided. So that's what you should be doing. Once you do your calculations, you do your costing, charge the 16% VAT, which you will bill the customer. Then the customer will deduct the relevant withholding tax for those consultancy services and remit them to KRA. So your role is to charge, I cost your service and charge 16% VAT. Then the customer, your customer, is the one who will withhold the VAT and remit it to KRA. Then depending on your incomes and expenditures, you may have to pay some amount of money as VAT liability for the month in question. But the point is this: cost your service, bill 16% VAT. Those withholding taxes are going to be handled by your client, not you. Then file your VAT return. If you have additional expenses on that particular transaction, which were charged VAT, you can claim those input VAT to reduce your 16% that you charged on that particular client. So cost and charge 16%. Withholding tax is the role of your client. How can a company legally evade taxes, especially in manufacturing or import? A cottage industry is on the rise. Less than Kenya shillings 2 million business. What could you advise to such a person? I have been trying to be very careful in what I say about this. Now, you cannot legally evade tax. You will be in a lot of trouble for legally, really evading tax is considered to be criminal. And there is a point where, even if you're doing that cottage industry, small business, informal sector, it gets to a point where the customers you're dealing with, your suppliers, your customers, they expect ETRs. Or alternatively, you go to a supplier and they ask for your PIN. So it gets to a point where it's not possible to continue hiding. And at that point, it makes sense just to formalize and do business above board. So in terms of evading tax, you cannot do it legally. You'll be in trouble. Yeah, it's true in Kenya that small business are on the rise. And this is where most of our people are employed in this country. They are employed in the informal sector. And especially for these businesses in the informal sector, begin planning on how you can formalize. It may not be possible to hide forever, especially as your business grows. There are a lot of opportunities that are available for formal businesses, compliant businesses. There are lots of opportunities. Look at, say, for example, supplying to government, you have to be tax compliant. If you want to supply to one of the larger formal organizations, you will have to be tax compliant. So it makes sense at some point, depending on the customers you're serving, to begin formalizing, getting into tax compliance sooner rather than later. Do it as a plan. The earlier you get into it, the better. Get that registration and comply. As I have said, the turnover tax, VAT returns, you can do it yourself. You will need your auditor at the end of the year to do the financial statements and file the income tax return for you at the end of the year. So it will make sense just to begin formalizing sooner rather than later. So for those opportunities, business opportunities, not to pass through your hands because you are not in tax compliance. Even financing will depend on whether you're registered, whether you are having tax compliance, whether you You know, I mean, it will depend on formality. So it makes sense to begin formalizing sooner rather than later. Kindly expound on how you file excise tax for a small water company. So this is, so again here, the best point is just talk to your accountant, your auditor, let them give you a way, a service where they can file the excise tax for your water company on a monthly basis. Avoid the penalties. For filing of these returns when they become multiple, you will have to decide whether you will engage the services of your auditor or whether you will hire an accountant to file those returns in-house. So either go to an auditor, your accountant will provide that service as a professional, or hire someone to work for your company and file these returns. So just explore the two options. When is withholding tax meant to be remitted? Immediately it is withdrawn. Immediately it is deducted, it is supposed to be remitted to KRA. Broadly elaborate tax avoidance. Tax avoidance is when you will use legal devices. Use legal devices, as we have mentioned, things that are in law that allow you to reduce your tax liability. We have given three examples today. We have given the example of the mortgage interest relief. We have given the example of the interest relief. We have given the example of the wear and tear allowance you can charge on property, plant, and equipment. So we have, hello, why does KRA not refund employees' excess tax filing the claim losses? That organization had deducted more than 1,000 to most of its customers for more than 2 years. Another scenario, by some employees in NGO came 40,000 or more deducted, and KRA has not refunded them after filing for reclaim. When your training staff are asked, they can't respond. It isn't this stealing from taxpayers? Okay, I feel you. Now, okay, especially with these claims, you need to do a lot of follow-up. And you know, sometimes we're busy and going to KRA, spending the whole day following up may not be what you can afford to do. And that's how, you know, sometimes we just let it go. Yes, well, but so, yeah, I empathize with that. But, you know, yeah, we've been there, we've followed up on things, we've given up also. Yeah, probably there could be some room for improvement there. For companies, is dividend and interest final? If so, when did this become effective? So this is for the withholding tax. When the company pays for the withholding tax on the dividends and interest are considered to be a final withholding tax. Then please, can you give us some thoughts on how to sell and buy land and rates which have changed by the county government or national government. Now, okay, when you sell land, the seller of the land will pay the capital gains tax on land. There are the land rent payable on all land that is under the Government Lands Act, usually by the 31st of January. Then it begins earning interest. Then there is the rates that are paid on all land that is under the Government Lands Act. Rates are charged on land under Government Lands Act, which is basically urban land, and rates are paid to the county government. So yeah, I mean, those are the three key taxes. Of course, there's a capital gains, there is going to be the land rent, and there is going to be the land rates. Land rent goes to the Ministry of Lands, land rates goes to the county government. So there you just have to go with your title to the relevant department and get an assessment of what you are supposed to pay. Again, avoid the taxes, penalties, and interest. So what are the benefits of taxation? Who would benefit from taxes? What are the methods of tax planning? What is the goal of tax planning? What is tax planning most common for? What are the factors that affect tax planning? What are the advantages and disadvantages of risk matrices? Many questions. Okay, taxation. Why do we pay taxes? At the end of the day, we will get services from government. How does government pay for the services it provides to us, the citizens? Government collects taxes. So basically, that's how we have government. Government sustains its operations, provides services by levying taxes. Tax planning. Legally, what we mean by tax planning, legally, can you reduce your tax liability? So in accordance to the laws we have in Kenya, what are the opportunities you have? What are the opportunities you have to reduce your tax liability? What are the opportunities you have to reduce your expenses and reduce your profits legally as a business person according to the laws we have? What do you expense? What don't you expense? As an individual, what reliefs can you get? What reliefs can't you get? As a business, what can you expense? What can't you expense? That is tax planning. Getting to know the legal devices that you can use to reduce your tax liability. It's done by who does tax planning? I mean, ideally, every individual, you have your property, you have your estate, you want to plan. Businesses, you have your assets, you have cash flow, you want to plan to retain as much cash flow in the business as possible for the benefit of the owners of the business. So tax planning is by both businesses and individuals. The risk matrix we had projected. The risk matrix maps out the various liabilities. Where would they arise? So what are the obligations, tax obligations, that you face as an organization? So that matrix maps out your various obligations. Are they indirect taxes? Are they corporation taxes on profits? Are they regulatory requirements, say, for example, standardization levy, such as a catering levy trustees? What are your obligations? Then, as an organization, once you identify all the tax liabilities you are exposed to, what is your risk of compliance or non-compliance? Is it low? Is it medium? Is it high? When it is high, you have a penalty somewhere that you have to pay. There is something you should have done you didn't do. When it is low, you take note that you may be exposed to this item. You can plan not to get exposed. That's why it makes sense to talk to a tax consultant, talk to your auditor, talk to your KRA accounts manager. Map out all your tax liabilities for your business very early on, even before you begin operations. I filed my annual return late and got a penalty. I've registered for a payment plan and have not received confirmation on how to repay. What happened to this? So probably here you may just go to your branch at KRA and find out what happened. Yeah, because you'll see that you cannot get a tax compliant because of that liability. You cannot get a tax compliance certificate because of that liability that hasn't been paid. So just go and talk to your KRA relevant branch and find out what happened and whether you can begin making the payment so that the documentation can be released and you can have the plan with you and you can begin paying. I filed my annual return late and got a penalty. I've registered a payment plan and I'm not, I think we've answered that one. If you are not pre-audit for more than 5 years, can KRA have the authority to request you for pre-audit after a long time? Tax Procedures Act requires you to hold documentation for 5 years. Once the 5 years are over, legally, you can make a decision on what to do with the documentation. But what Tax Procedures Act requires you to do is to hold them for 5 years so an audit can be done before the expiry of 5 years. After 5 years, you decide what to do with the documentation. You can keep it in archive or you can dispose it. The Tax Procedures Act requires you to hold evidence of your transactions for 5 years. If one is paying a mortgage, is one exempt from MRI? I believe that is mortgage interest relief. So if you are paying a mortgage with one of the organizations that can issue you with a mortgage interest certificate, once you request a mortgage interest certificate, you can apply for a mortgage interest relief in your income tax return up to 300,000 shillings. So if you must have the mortgage interest certificate, I opened a KRA PIN, filed late returns due to difference in financial year. The company hasn't done any good task yet. I was penalized. Can company waiver be accepted? If yes, what could be the procedure? Just go to your iTax and apply for the waiver. Sooner or later, you will get a response whether your waiver has been accepted or rejected. So just file for a waiver. They will get in touch with you. They will. It's an email that comes and says whether the waiver has been accepted or not. Then you can know what to do after that. What if an individual...
William.
Yes.
We have run out of time, but we can maybe extend it for 10 more minutes and as we conclude...
That's okay. I can see more questions are coming up. Eh?
Yes. Let's aim to stop at 12:45.
Uh-huh. So how many more minutes? So what time are you giving?
Let's aim for 12:45 because I can see the questions are really many.
Yes. Okay, yeah. Thank you. Great. So what if an individual is Kenyan citizen working in the US and getting employment income in the US where tax is deducted in USA by a US firm? Is there tax liability in Kenya? A government of Kenya expects you to file a tax return on your incomes, even when you are not a resident. Government of Kenya expects you to file a tax return even when you are located elsewhere. Government of Kenya expects. There's the expectation also that you will declare those incomes you're earning abroad and also pay taxes on them. Whether people do it or not, that's debatable, but Government of Kenya still expects you to file a tax return. Are consultants supposed to pay VAT? Yes, see, consultancy services, we get billed at 16% VAT. Consultants are supposed to pay VAT, yes. I have a small business that is VAT registered. Is it a must to pay VAT amount to cash sale clients that are not VAT registered? Absolutely. That is why we have the electronic tax registers. What is the requirement is that every transaction you enter into ought to be charged VAT. That's the requirement. Again, whether people do it or not, it's not always. Sometimes you see those electronic tax registers are put very far away. It's only brought out when you ask for an electronic tax register receipt. But the expectation from the view of the tax authority is that every sale ought to have an electronic tax register receipt. If commercial rental income is less than, is it compulsory to pay VAT? You see, now again, it depends on who your clients are. Do they want you to pay VAT? Do they want to you to want? Do they want to claim the commercial? Do they want to claim the input VAT that you charged them? If they want to claim input VAT, then you go ahead. Residential property, you pay the residential income. The residential income tax at 10%. For commercial properties, ideally it is supposed to be charged VAT, and the customer claims the VAT as an input tax. In the case of the KRA account manager has changed 4 times and still matters pending for more than 3 years, what can be done? Okay, Okay, now that is where you just need to be continue just going to KRA offices. What do I say? Just continue consulting with your KRA until you have a point where you can conclude. I know it requires a lot of effort. It requires a lot of effort, a lot of sacrifice. I know times you go there and you just give up and go back. But you know, some of these matters, the monetary amount may be high and it just keeps persistence. Alternatively, you can hire a tax consultant to pursue the matter on your behalf and to bring that matter to a resolution. But I feel you, sometimes we go there and you spend the day there and probably work, things are going bad and you don't get a resolution. And that is why a tax consultant may help you resolve the matter. Your auditor also can go there and solve the matter on your behalf. Then, Michelle, how many more minutes?
5 more minutes.
Okay. So for small business, rely on clients paying in order to pay KRA. How do you handle payments for VAT if you have already invoiced the client and you are yet to be paid? Again, if you look for VAT, ideally the month you sold is the month that you're supposed to declare. But what happens in reality is that your customer pays you a long time after, 3 months down the line. Ideally, the month you billed the customer is the month that income is supposed to be declared for VAT. But it's also a fact that sometimes your customers pay you in 3 months or 4 months, and there's also a risk that that debt can also go bad, yet you had already declared it. But there are avenues through which you can take recourse where the debts go bad. Yes, so yes, there's that issue. So you declared it this month, customer hasn't paid you, and you do not have cash to pay for the VAT liability. It's something small businesses are impacted on frequently, probably even monthly. For sole proprietorships, is it advisable to get a business KRA PIN, or I can use my personal KRA PIN for the business? I have seen people who have a separate PIN for the business. I have seen people who use their own personal PIN. So they have registered a business name. You're a sole proprietor. You've registered a business name. And when it comes now to paying for your taxes, you use your own KRA PIN to declare those taxes. So you can use your own PIN as an individual, and you can also register a separate PIN for the business. If company is not TOT, does the company have to file annual tax return? If a company is on TRT, does the company have to file the annual tax return? TOT is filed monthly. It's a final tax. So what would arise is for the income, TOT turnover tax is a final tax. So the annual returns now would have to be for the business owner. The business owners themselves would still have to file their individual income tax returns. Talking about KRA account manager, does KRA, no, it's not. That's your account manager. You just consult and you get the information you have. It's not a charged service. It's not a business service. It is your account manager advising you what you should do. So it is not charged. You just give a call, you are explained on phone, or you go to the office, you are explained there. It's not a charged service. For limited companies, are dividends and interest final tax? For limited companies, are dividends interest? Dividends are what you pay your shareholders. There is a withholding tax on that. Interest is what you pay your bondholders if you have any. There is a withholding tax on that. Then it's a final, meaning that the shareholder does not have to pay some additional tax on those dividends after you've received the dividend check. So for limited companies, are dividends, I think we've handled that. Documentary evidence sent to KRA and amended in portal was not carried out. The wrong period was indicated, 2017. To date, that issue was not corrected. Every year, the same issue comes up. Every time, the same document submitted. After that, numerous times to update their record, it has not been done. How can I get KRA to amend records? This affects my tax compliance. Again, affects a lot of people. Polesana. Can you engage a tax consultant to take up the matter on your behalf? Then in online advertising, revenue is divided between publisher and platform owner. Who between the two is subject to digital service tax? Is that service taxable anyway, since it isn't a subscription? Okay, that one. So online advertising, revenue is divided between publisher and platform owner. Who between the two is subject to the tax? The beneficiary, principal beneficiary, by law is the one who is required to pay the tax, whether you are a resident or not. As long as you make revenue through online platforms, the beneficiary, the person making the money, is required to pay the digital transactions tax. The beneficiary, who is the beneficiary? Who is the principal beneficiary? How can I give suggestions to what to look at before registering as a consultant? And what are the tax percentage for a consultant as compared to someone employed? It is always better to operate as a consultant because you are doing consulting business. You have revenues, you have expenses. You can register for VAT, you're registered for income tax. So for VAT, you will pay the net tax. So you have your output tax, you charge your customer, there's input tax you charge on your expenditures. you pay the net. As an individual, as an employed individual, your tax is going to be based on pay as you earn if you are employed. As a consultant, you have your VAT liability being the net tax. Then number two, when it comes to expenses, you have your sales, you have your expenses. You will net your expenses against your income, and you have your net profit, which is subjected to tax, which is what you cannot do that when you are employed. It's preferable to operate as a consultant. If you have been registered for VAT, but the company that you offered contractual services withheld 2%, what should you do? So what you do, you get the withholding tax certificate, declare it when you're supposed to declare it. So they withheld 2%. You now, when you file your return the following month, remember you are the one who sold. You sold to them, you have a sale. They have retained 2%, which they have paid to KRA. Now, what you pay to KRA will depend on whether you had other expenses with VAT input tax that month. So you would take, you would declare that withholding tax certificate, one. Number two, you will declare the sale. You will declare the withholding tax certificate. Then you will also declare your other input taxes, your purchases, which will also have VAT. Then the net amount is what you're supposed to pay. So it will be how much you pay will depend on whether you had other purchases for which were charged input VAT. So I think we are done. One more. No, I think we've answered that also. So thank you very much. I hope the questions were answered. Or at least we have shed some light on what to do. So thank you very much. Also, quite a number of items going on in chat.
In the chat box, yes. William, I think this has been the best Q&A session we've had so far. And the participants can attest to that.
A lot of us are impacted, you know, by this thing, yes. You know. Yes. So I feel you, we're small business people, same thing every time, you know. Well, yes, but I believe we have just given some light onto what you do. Get advice, talk to your auditor, talk to your accountant. Start it from there. KRA account manager is also available. Thank you very much.
Great, ladies and gentlemen, Michelle. Thank you so much for being with us this far. And if you have any further questions for William, I'm sure once we share the presentations with you, his contacts will be available and you can email him for further questions. And happy Mashujaa Day, guys. And thank you so much. Let's meet next week for module 8 on investor readiness. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Asante.
Thank you.
Good afternoon.